The Bible says, and the Lord anointed other 70. Everybody with me? He looked upon the masses. He looked upon the multitude. And God's heart throbbed of compassion because he wanted to heal them. Are you with me?
Cast all your cares upon the Lord. Cast all your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you. Going through, why don't you cast all your cares upon the Lord?
And in Matthew 9, when you've found it, please stand, and the latter portion of chapter 9 will be coming. You I want to read responsibly to again today again. You found us, say amen. Beginning at verse 27. And when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying and saying, Thou son of David, have mercy on us.
And when he was come into the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus saith unto them, Believe ye that I am able to do this? They said unto him, Yea, Lord.
Then touched he their eyes, saying, According to your faith, be it unto you.
And their eyes were opened, and Jesus straightly charged them, saying, See that no man know it.
But they, when they were departed, spread abroad his fame in all that country.
As they went out, behold, they brought to him a dumb man possessed with a devil.
And when the devil was cast out, the dumb spake, and the multitudes marveled, saying, It was never so seen in Israel.
But the Pharisees said, He casteth out devils through the prince of the devils.
And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people.
But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd.
Then saith he to his disciples, The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvests. Amen. Father, thank you again for the word of God. We ask your blessings upon it now. Lord, you're in this place. You're here, Lord God. You are your word. Make it real to us today again, that we may grasp, Lord, the goodness of our Savior. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. I want to talk a little about the compassion of the Lord. We are familiar with God's rebuke when we need to be in line. We're familiar with words of correction. We're familiar with the times and things, the Lord's desire to help us. And today I want to remind you, I feel the Lord wants me to speak a bit about the compassion of the Lord. There's so many things about God that we are to learn, but one of the things that is so needful and helpful for us, especially when we face things continually, is to know of God's compassion. And the last few weeks have been challenging to me, and just some things that were just challenging and just There were no words for them, but in the midst of it, the Lord began to show his compassion and minister his love in a very special way. And so as I had an occasion this week, he could feel that compassion of God, and he began to talk to me about his compassion when we are suffering. And you know, the good thing about when God allows you to go through, he's bringing you in a place and a position so that you can receive of his grace. And he said, they that are whole have no need of a physician, right? But when we find ourselves in need, then we are candidates for God's grace and mercy. And so take courage if you are in a position where you feel lowly or weak, challenged, just know this, that the Lord is near those of a broken heart, and save it such that be of a contrite heart. That's what the word says, right? Amen. This is the nature of God. So we look here in this text today, and we see verse 35 says, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. We find here in 37 and 38, where he was saying the harvest is plentiful, and the laborers, but the laborers are few. So pray to the Lord of harvest that he may send forth laborers. And someone was calculating and saying, even in New York City, if 100 souls were saved a day by the Christians, at the end of the year, it would be such a tiny, tiny portion of the needs of people being met everywhere. It's amazing. So the need is extremely great. And Jesus preached in all the cities and villages, and knew from a personal point of view or from personal experience, as he went through all the towns, the cities, and the villages, preaching and teaching, he knew from personal experience the needs that ordinary people had. Things that made life difficult for the ordinary people as he traveled back and forth through the towns and cities. He saw the need. Before he made an appeal to them about discipleship, the mission of following him in verse chapter 10. But just walk you through now, 8 and 9 really shows you a lot, just some of the activities that went on. Chapter 8, verse 2, behold, there came, when he came down from the mountain, came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you will, you can make me clean. Jesus put forth his hand, touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Verse 5 says, when he was entered into Capernaum, there came to him a centurion beseeching him, saying, Lord, my servant lie at home sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. Jesus said to him, I'll come and heal him. And you know the story of the centurion, his attitude, how God commended his faith. And he got what his heart desired because of his faith. Look at verse 14. When Jesus was coming to Peter's house, he saw his mother-in-law, his wife, mother lay sick of a fever. You see these, the variety of needs, right? He touched her hand, the fever left her. When evening was come, they brought to him many that were possessed with devils, cast out the spirit with his word, and healed them that were sick, right? Just moving, moving, verse 18, when Jesus saw the multitude about him, gave commandment to depart to the other side. Talks about the scribe there, and going down to 23, when he was entered into the ship, his disciples followed him. There arose a great tempest. There they were afraid, right there in the ship boat with him. God spoke to their fears and calmed the sea, the water, right? Verse 31, go to the devil. Verse 28, when he was come to the other side of the country, Gergesenes, there met him two possessed with the devils, coming out of the tomb, exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass that way. Can you see the needs? Everywhere he was going, right? All right. Look at chapter 9. We see they brought to him one that was paralyzed, right? Lying in a bed. And Jesus spoke to him. And then, you know, of course, the scribes and Pharisees couldn't understand that language. And so they were frustrated with him. But he healed him, right? And then we go on. There was another, of course, Matthew. Then the call of Matthew is pointed out. And we move on down to verse 18. There came a certain ruler. Okay, he had a need, right? My daughter, now dead. Come lay your hands on. Jesus rose and followed him. This is just a little glimpse of the mobilization of Jesus or the activities, right? Look at verse 20. And behold, a woman which was diseased with an issue of blood 12 years came behind and touched him of his garment. Just needs, right? Okay. Finally, he got to the ruler's house and did what needed to be done. Verse 27. When Jesus departed from there, two blind men followed, crying, Son of David, have mercy. Y'all getting the picture? Touched him, made him whole. Verse 32. And as they went out, behold, they brought to him a dumb man possessed with the devil. When the devil was cast out, the dumb spake, the multitudes marveled, saying, we've never seen it like this. But it doesn't stop there. Verse 35, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogue, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing every sickness and every disease among the people. It was after he had traveled, moved about, and everywhere he turned, everywhere he went, there was somebody having a need. And he didn't fail. He met every one of them. Wow. Look at somebody say, Lord, help us to be more like you. He met every need. He met every need. And then here, the Bible says in verse 36, after going through the cities and villages, seeing the needs of humanity, he looks on the crowd in a certain, this particular instance, and said, when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion. Therein lies one of the secrets of Jesus' success. Therein will lie the secret of our success as we connect to the God of compassion. Isn't that right? Jesus was so moved with compassion. I haven't had a lot of experiences. I've had some where I was moved with compassion. I never really understood it until I had that experience, wherein this compassion was not mine. It was the compassion of Jesus. Boy, did I want to help some kind of bad. I had such a desire to help. Two or three instances that happened. But it was as I was going, doing service, that compassion was on me when the need arose. And that compassion, trust me, brothers and sisters, is not our compassion. Our compassion, it does not work like that. But that compassion will move you to no end. It'll cause you to want to see the person helped. And so Jesus was moved on many occasions. In the Gospels, it said he was moved of compassion. Moved on compassion in the first part of chapter 9, or the lepers, or chapter 8. He said, a leper said, "Lord, if you will, you can make me whole." He was an outcast, but he said, "Lord, if you will, you can make me whole." Jesus was moved with that compassion. And he said, "I do. I will. I want to. Be whole." This is our Lord now. This is our Lord whom we serve, we love, and we may be facing things, but trust me, Jesus does not change. He still has compassion. But when we're going through ordinary people facing difficulties, life was made difficult for them. And then we see the vulnerability of these people. The Bible says, "But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd." If you couldn't just picture a sheep without a shepherd, and a multitude at that, they don't know what direction to go in. They can't hear that voice of a shepherd because they have no shepherd. So they become vulnerable. They stand to be exploited, right? They stand to be taken advantage of. So Jesus looked at them and he had this compassion on them, and he was so moved because there they were. He saw how vulnerable they were. God is a God of compassion. You may be challenged and facing things, and it may seem like nobody really understands what I am going through. But God does. And not only does he understand, but he cares. He cares about how you're being oppressed, how we're being oppressed. He sees it. And God wanted me to say and remind his people that I see. But more than I see, I'm going to do something about it. Hallelujah. Going to do something about it. Look at the nature of Jesus. He didn't just assess the needs and says, "Oh boy, these people are like sheep having no shepherd." He said, "I have compassion on the multitude," right? And then he went about everywhere just healing and setting them free. So I was like, "Okay, God, what can we learn?" He said, "One thing, look at the demonic activities." So they were vulnerable. And up in verse 32, he says, "And they went out, they brought to him a dumb man possessed with a devil or demon. When the devil or demon was cast out, the dumb spake and the multitude marveled." You and I do not know the depths of what one may be going through that's oppressed by the evil one. He's real. He's not an imagination. He exists in a world of darkness. And he's out oppressing people. Oppressing people that are vulnerable and don't know that God can help them. maybe not in touch with the great God of the universe, don't know how to call upon him. They're oppressed everywhere, every nation, every kindred, and every race. People are being oppressed in such a way. And just the little area that Jesus was, he went from city to city and town as he walked through there and healing everywhere. It was like he said, oh, I see the multitudes, and they're so vulnerable to the evil attacks of Satan and so many other things, but I have compassion on them. He says, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. So he did something about it. In the next chapter here, we see that he called to himself the disciples. And he anointed them and sent them forth. He realized when he operated with the limitations of humanity, he knew that that wasn't sufficient. And so he took and he anointed 12 others and he dispersed them. Luke tells us that beyond the 12, that still wasn't sufficient. The Bible says, and the Lord anointed other 70. Everybody with me? He looked upon the masses. He looked upon the multitude. And God's heart throbbed of compassion because he wanted to heal them. Are you with me? He was saying there is a need for more of the Jesus ministry. He was saying there's a need for more of my followers to copy what I have been doing. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So it is the time where God, he was talking to me about the compassion and putting upon my heart, there's more that I want from you. There's more that I want from you. Oh, people are hurting. They're hurting. They're bruised and they're battered. And they're being exposed and exploited by many different things. And it's like he said, I want more from you. I want more of my compassion displayed that people might know that I really care. God said in the Old Testament to Moses, he said, Moses, I've surely seen the afflictions of my people, and I've come down to help them. Moses said, what you gonna do? He said, I'm sending you. You don't know how God may be responding to the needs at this hour. But as we are sensitive to God, he wants to get our full undivided attention and say, I'm putting in you and I have put in you my spirit and my life. Hallelujah. And my gifts and my anointing. Because I want to show the compassion that I have for hurting humanity. They are like sheep having no shepherd. So there is room. Look at somebody and say, there is room for all of us to work in the vineyard of our God. Hallelujah. There's much room. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, so now he said, pray that the Lord of the harvest would send forth laborers. I hope it stirs you like it stirred my heart. Oh, there's so much work to be done. Hallelujah. When we take on his values, are you hearing me? And we take on our commitment for his cause, are you with me? It'll move you to do something about it. And this is what God wants, to move us into the action. But I want you to know that for us individually, God says, I'm going to do something about your situation. Because I have compassion. I've seen these people were, hallelujah, subject to demonic activity. They were subject politically. They bore the burdens of heavy taxes. servitude and human right violation. Sounds familiar? The religious teachers were not providing or teaching, providing the kind of teaching that would help them. And then the pastor care and help for their material lives and their needs was not met. They endured also leprosy, fevers, chronic illnesses, demon possession, blindness, paralysis, and many other troubles. Jesus knew, but he responded with compassion. I am so amazed that somebody as mighty and as important as Jesus. Can I throw a little tidbit in here? The less important we feel, the easier it is to respond to human suffering. I looked at this, and somebody said, Jesus, here, so and so and so, this is my daughter's got a problem here. Jesus says, I will come and heal her. This is the Lord from heaven. And I thought about myself, good God. Sometime, I don't know, to be willing like that. But thank God he's working on me. But every one of those situations that I read, here he was. I'll come and help. I'll come and heal. They say, do so. He just got right up. Look at the humility. Look at the love that he has. Look at the compassion of Jesus. So he needs, he said, pray to the Lord of harvest that you have raised up more Jesus kind of ministries. Isn't that right? Pastors, if you're like me, this is good for you. But God is like he's saying, don't get too important. That human needs, you're overlooking them. If Jesus could meet the needs of the common man, it tells us. And he's a bishop, isn't that right? He's a great apostle, isn't that right? I'm like the preacher said on yesterday, that was for me. But God is crying out and saying, I've anointed you now. I have compassion upon the hurting ones. Yeah, I'm giving them my word that I might straighten things out for them, but now I want the compassion to embrace them. Deliver them. Somebody gonna get delivered today. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Jesus responded with compassion.
Cast all your cares upon the Lord. Cast all your cares upon the Lord.